Hello friends, we were discussing preparing a research proposal, and we have been discussing the different components of a research proposal. We have come up to methods. We have just started with methods, then we took the break. So now Dr. Vandana Singh is with us. She will discuss with you in detail what is that particular component of a research proposal, methods. The different aspects of methods she will discuss with you. And I hope during the break you have discussed in your group or with your resource persons the discussion which we had in the previous session. And if you have any kind of query, or if you have a point of discussion which you feel you want to have with us or with other peer groups sitting in the different parts of the country, you can ask us those questions. In the meanwhile, Vandana will begin with methods. But we do hope you keep interacting with us. You can just phone in and let us know your queries, clarifications, or if you want to bring in a particular point for a discussion. Now, I'll request Vandana to start with methods. Vandana.
Thank you, Dr. Aisha. And good afternoon to all of you, those who are hearing us. And as in the last session, we have already discussed about the various components of a research proposal. And I think we have come up to we have already covered the title, the objectives, and how to write hypothesis. When you have already talked about, or when you have already decided about what title you are or what study you are going to undertake, the next and the very important step which you have to consider is to choose the correct research methodology. What kind of a method would you be using to carry out that research? That is very important. So before that, we go into what are the different kinds of methods which you can adopt. Let us first see what do we mean by research method. As you can see on slide, there is a definition by Sandra Harding. A research method is a technique for gathering evidences. Whenever you are going to undertake any research, for example, if you want to find out the achievement level in the primary school children, then the method which you would be adopting, that will give the way that what kind of results you will get. So that means a method always tells you and always guides you to collect the evidences, to collect the relative data for the particular title for which you have chosen. So a research method, choosing a correct research method, is a very, very important step. When we talk about the importance of methods and methodology, there is one thing which is very, very important and which is always said, that the most common error which we always do while conducting a research is choosing a wrong research method. If you choose a wrong research method, then what will happen? Your all conclusions, that means your all this, the results of the study will also not be sound. So friends, this is a very crucial step. So that is why if you have any confusion while the discussion, you can just break in and you can always ask, because this is very important. There are various kinds of research methods which you can adopt, but basically on the basis of the nature of the data, that is, whether the data is numerical or whether the data is descriptive, the research methods are basically divided into two types. that is the qualitative and the quantitative research methods. Let us now see what are the characteristics of a qualitative and a quantitative research method. When we talk about a qualitative method of research, it means that it is basically basing the research is revolving around a description of a particular event. That doesn't include numbers or numerics. So that means it's a description wherein a researcher will always try to collect a thick data about the research. And it, as you can see on the slide, that a qualitative method, it relies on the feelings, impressions and judgments of the sample.
Call from Delhi.
Yes, please, we can have the call.
Yes, Delhi.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, I have certain questions related to the preparation of the project proposal itself. You talked about delimitation. Can you please explain what do you mean by delimitation? And further, you said the objectives to be specified. Kindly tell which objective, behavioral or instructional?
And the second question, can you repeat?
Yes, ma'am, I repeat.
Yes.
Please pinpoint which objectives are to be specified, behavioral or instructional. And then I have certain queries about the project report also, like whether it should be spiral bound or hard bound, and the number of copies to be submitted, and the page length, is there any maximum or minimum limit on the words or the pages?
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am.
So just to respond to your query about delimitations, delimitations are those circumstances wherein the researcher himself or herself wants to delimit the study to a particular level. Limitation, whereas, is things which are beyond your control, the researcher's control. So therefore, that is a limitation from the outside agency. Like, whereas delimitation is, it is within your control, but at the same time, you are delimiting the level of the study, or you are delimiting the different aspects of the study.
Yes.
Things which are very much within your control. It has nothing to do with the external agency. But at the same time, due to various reasons, due to various circumstances, or due to the nature of the study, you would like to delimit certain aspects of the study, or certain components, variables of the study. That is what is known as a delimitation.
Dr. Aisha, we can take one example of the delimitation also.
For
example, if you want to conduct a study to find out the study habits of adolescents, then if you are a researcher, say in Delhi, then you would delimit your study. Your delimitation would be that because there is a lot of expense in terms of time and money, so obviously you would like to delimit yourself to the periphery of the Delhi, and moreover to the students maybe residing in Delhi. And if you want to further delimit yourself, you can also delimit to the adolescent group maybe studying in a private school or in a government school. So delimitation would become the delimitation of this kind of the study would be the study is delimited to the Delhi region only, or the study is delimited to, say, government children studying in government school or in private school.
Yes.
I think that is what we mean by delimitation, as Dr. Aisha was also referring to, that is certain aspects.
Okay, we will take another call which is coming in. Where is it from?
Patna.
Yes, Patna.
Hello?
Yes, yes.
Hello, ma'am, I wanted to ask you whether the hypothesis is needed for every research.
Your question is
Supposed
over?
Yes, and I have one more question.
Yes, hello ma'am, I am Anita Jha from Patna.
Yes, Anita.
I have a question that collecting a sample, say, from the student of certain school or college, what should be the number of, what should be the sample size, that is,
okay,
100 or how many students?
Okay. So we will just respond to Delhi first, and Vandana, then perhaps you would like to say whether, because now it will also be related to the methods, like, you know, whether hypothesis is needed in all the study, and sampling in any case we are going to discuss in detail right now. I am going to respond to Delhi. It's about objectives of the study. So whether it has to be behavioral objective or instructional objective. Herein we are not going to make any such classification or differentiation, because here we are talking about what do you want to find out through this study? What do you want to discover through this study? What do you want to invent through this study? So that is what the objectives of a research study. So I gave you example. If we take the first title I gave you earlier, that is A Study of Meaning in Life, Stress and Burnout in Primary School Teachers in Delhi. So one of the objectives, therefore, to study if teachers varied in the degree of overall meaning in life. So through this particular study, you want to find out if teachers varied in the degree of overall meaning in life. So this is one of the objectives of your research study. You don't have to exactly put it under behavioral objectives or instructional objectives, just as you do in your lesson planning. That is not expected here. Here, the meaning of objectives is to actually to clearly tell you and the reader what you are going to do. And once you submit your report, the reader gets the idea what were you going to find out, or what were you going to study or examine. And then obviously they will tally it vis-a-vis your finding. What do you aim to find out or aim to study or to examine, then what you have found out. I hope you understand. When I say that, you know, there is absolutely no need for differentiating it as a behavioral objective or a instructional objective. This is different from the lesson plan writing. Vandana?
We will respond to the next question, which has come from Patna.
Yes.
During my presentation itself, because I'll be discussing about it in detail in the presentation. So we were discussing about the qualitative research, as I was discussing with you that the qualitative research does not deal with numbers, rather it deals with the words or the feeling, or rather it is a description of the events that we are doing. So whenever you are going to undertake a descriptive kind of or a qualitative kind of a research, then you are expected to deal with the data descriptively. And since the qualitative research focuses more on the feelings and also on the impressions of the individual, so there is always a chance of biasness. So that is a major limitation of the qualitative research. And also the other limitation of this research is the lack of representativeness, because the qualitative research, sometimes the number which we take in a qualitative research usually is not that large. Because of that, we cannot say that it is a representative of the population. I think we have another call. Let's just take up that call.
It's from Jaipur. Yes, Jaipur. Please go ahead, Jaipur.
Disconnected now.
Okay.
Okay, the call has disconnected, so we'll just move on. So the next kind of the method which you can always see is the quantitative method. As the name always tells you, it is basically, because it's a quantitative research, so that means the data which will you be using in the quantitative research would be all numerical data, or it will be involving numbers. And it will have large, as compared to the qualitative research where the subject or the sample is quite low, here in the quantitative research the number of the sample is quite large, and because of that there is a good representation. So the limitation of the qualitative research is overcome by the quantitative research, just because the total number of the sample is larger in a quantitative research as compared to the qualitative research. There is an example which you can also see on the slide, that is a survey research. Suppose you want to find out, say, you want to find out what is the perception of children towards the educational television. So to find out that perception, you will have to take a larger sample. That means the sample of the students which you would like to have to be larger. Because the sample is large, so the representation of the research and also the generalization of the research would be better. I think we have another call.
Now Jaipur is waiting. Yes.
Yeah, very good afternoon, ma'am. Myself, Dr. Ankita Sharma.
Yes.
From Jaipur. I have a query that how can we frame the hypothesis? Please support with the example. Thank you.
Do you have any?
First of all, let me just tell you what hypothesis is. A hypothesis is nothing but a tentative solution to a problem. So whenever you have chosen a research title, say for example, to find out the relationship between learning style and academic achievement of the student studying in class 9th. So your main objective is to find out the relationship between learning style and the academic achievement. So when you are going to frame your hypothesis, the hypothesis would be framed like that there is a relationship. We are not going to comment on positive or a negative, but there is a relationship between, say, learning style and academic achievement of the student. So this hypothesis, since this hypothesis which you are framing, this hypothesis is telling you that you have to test the relationship. This, after testing this hypothesis, you will get to know that what kind of relationship is there between learning style and academic achievement. Is it positive or is it negative? So that means we can say that hypothesis always helps you in testing the objectives what you have framed for the study.
Now, Vandana, you know, very often what happens, you know, it's from some of the research proposals and later research proposal they have a hypothesis, and later on when they submit the research report, they do have the hypothesis, but nowhere the hypothesis is tested. So when we write a hypothesis, then we also have to test the hypothesis in the course of that research study.
Yes.
So then that should be part of the research report.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, merely writing a hypothesis is not enough.
Yes.
So hypothesis should be tested,
mm-hmm.
and therein finally you say whether this particular hypothesis is accepted or is
rejected.
Not accepted. Like, so you have to keep that in mind, because we have often come across hypothesis is mentioned but it is not tested anywhere. I suppose we have another call waiting.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear you. Yeah. Can we have a question,
Namaskar,
please?
Madam.
Namaskar.
Hello.
Boliye.
Yeah. Hello. Price of research में first में दो तरह की बताया गया है आपके द्वारा अभी. एक है qualitative method और दूसरा है quantitative method.
जी.
तो दोनों का प्रयोग एक साथ किसी भी research में सामान्य तौर पे होता है या फिर कोई एक का selection करना होता है? और अगर कोई एक का करना है तो फिर उसके क्या कारण हो सकते हैं? जहाँ तक मेरी समझ है कि प्रत्येक रिसर्च में कहीं ना कहीं दोनों ही मेथड का प्रयोग होता है, तो इस संदर्भ में हम आपसे स्पष्ट रूप से जानकारी चाहता हूँ. ओके, थैंक यू.
थैंक यू वेरी मच.
थैंक यू. सी, देयर इज समथिंग नोन एज ट्रायंगुलेशन. देयर इन यू यूज triangulation, obviously it means three methods. So there is always a provision for, or it depends on the researcher what you want to do, how you design your study. Do you want to have both a quantitative paradigm and qualitative paradigm through which you would like to conduct your study? So it is entirely up to the researcher how the researcher designs a study. So there is no hard and fast rule that, you know, you have to compartmentalize it. Like, so you can have both. So when exactly these two methods or different methods come in, that depends on you, the way you design your research.
Yes, you can always use a combination of both the research, the qualitative and the quantitative. See, when as we have already discussed, in a qualitative research, the focus is more on description. So, for example, if you want to find out what are the cultural practices in a certain tribe, then obviously the number will not come in. There you will take the help of interview maybe, or maybe an observation where you will write down all the descriptions. So in such a study, the qualitative method would be used. But in other, only the quantitative methods could be used. For example, as I stated, that is to find out the learning style of the student and to relate it with the academic achievement. In that case, you would be using the tests which have already been standardized. You will get some number out of it, and academic achievement maybe you will get some numbers out of it, and then you are going to relate or correlate both of them. So this is purely a quantitative research. But yes, you can, as Dr. Aisha has said, that you can always use both the methods together. That will all depend what kind of the study are you going to take up. That is a big thing. So we were discussing about the two types of methods, and within qualitative and quantitative, we can also further classify them into various types, as you can see on the slides itself, that a quantitative method and a qualitative method, when you look at towards the left side of the slide, under the qualitative research methods, what we have written is ethnography, case study, survey, sometimes focus group discussions, then text analysis. So if you see all the five which have been listed under the qualitative research, they all includes the thick description of the data. I think we have another call from Pune. Let us take that call. Yeah. Yes, hello Pune.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, please. You can have the question.
Good afternoon, madam.
Good afternoon.
There's a question. I want to know that what is the differentiation between method and methodology?
That's
Thank
all.
You.
Okay, very nice question. Method and methodology. See, when we are talking about method is just the direction to carry out the research. Instead, when you are talking about methodology is basically when we come out from the it's a, maybe we can say, a philosophy of a method. That is, various disciplines have got their own methodology to carry out research, but the methodology, from the methodology, various methods are being derived. For example, scientific methodology or maybe social sciences methodology. But within that, there could be various methods, for example, experimental research or case study or etc. So methodology is a larger, we can understand in a layman form that it is a larger cloud wherein different methods.
It has several components,
yes.
Like, you know, in the case of a research, like, you know, if for a particular study, if we are writing a subheading as a methodology, that will include sampling.
Yes.
And then the particular statistical technique you will be using to test the hypothesis, or the tools you would be using to collect the data, all these things put together would form your methodology.
Yes.
Whereas a method is each different components that comes under that, like, you know, the particular method you use to collect the data, or the particular tool you use to collect the data. So these are all the different components which come under that methodology. Methodology is per se that is the entire design.
Yes.
Like, you know.
Okay, yes, Shillong. Yes, can we have a question from Shillong?
Yes, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
We have some queries regarding submission of the proposal. Should we submit to the coordinator at our regional center or coordinator at Delhi? And one more thing is that, do we have to work under a guide or any supervisor, ma'am?
Okay, see, your first query I already...
And regarding the project, how many pages should it come to and how many copies do we have to make? Thank you.
Okay. About your first query, I think I already responded to that in the previous session. That is, your research report should be sent to SR&E division, the registrar SR&E division. I said it has to go through the evaluation process, therefore it will have to come through SR&ED. Please refer to your program guide.
it's written clearly there where you should send. The address is given there. Please do that. Don't send it directly to the program coordinator in Delhi, that is Poonam Bhushan from School of Education. What will happen? It will come to her. She'll have to send it back to the SRND to get the registration done there. Then it will come back. So in the process, you will suffer because it will delay. So therefore, please send it to the SRNE division, that is Students Registration and Evaluation Division. Your research proposal you can send directly to Poonam Bhushan at the School of Education, that is your program coordinator. Please don't submit any of these things to your regional center, because if you do that, they will have to send it to the headquarters again. In that process, it will get delayed. And about the number of pages, I am not going to tell you how many pages it should be. See, it's a project study as part of your PGDHE. So therefore, you are not expected to write a dissertation like your MA or MPhil, or you are not expected to write it like your PhD thesis. So it has to be precise and concise. It doesn't have to have too many pages. So restrict, because your sample will also be small, so it is done in a very small scale. So therefore, don't go by how many words and all that, because we have not put any such a restriction, but you are not expected to do a large scale study. I think another call is waiting.
I think we have a call from Jaipur now. Can we have a question, please?
Hello.
Yes.
Yes.
Hello, huh?
Yes.
मैडम जी नमस्ते.
नमस्ते
मैडम जी. जब हम रिसर्च प्रोजेक्ट पे काम करते हैं तो हमारे पास दो तरह के डेटा हम यूज करते हैं. एक तो होता है प्राइमरी डेटा, एक होता है सेकेंडरी डेटा. कई बार क्या होता है कि जो रिसर्चर होता है वो सेकेंडरी डेटा का ज्यादा प्रयोग करता है, यानी कि प्राइमरी डेटा का कलेक्शन वो नहीं कर पाता है. तो ऐसी अवस्था में वो सेकेंडरी डेटा का अगर ज्यादा प्रयोग करता है तो कहीं कुछ गलत तो नहीं होता है, या प्रोजेक्ट पे कुछ स्टैटिस्टिकल डिपार्टमेंट से रहता है, मान लो अलग अलग डिपार्टमेंट से रहता है, इनका कोई कुछ गलत प्रभाव तो नहीं पड़ता है?
सी, इट डिपेंड्स ऑन योर यू नो रिसर्च प्रॉब्लम. इन सर्टेन केसेस प्राइमरी डेटा, वन थिंग यू कैन नॉट फाइंड. फॉर एग्जांपल, इफ यू आर कंडक्टिंग हिस्टोरिकल रिसर्च, मोस्ट पीपल मे बी ऑलरेडी डेड, सो यू कैनॉट हैव अ प्राइमरी सोर्स. सो देयरफॉर what you actually do is something which they have written, or if you are studying about a particular institution's 100 years of existence, and obviously you can't find the first vice chancellor or someone like that, they all may be dead already. So therefore, whatever comes in the form of a document there, you will be analyzing that, which is of course the secondary source of data. And in case, like, you know, someone who has worked with those people, you may be interviewing them or collecting data from them. So by and large, it depends on the nature of the you know, study you are undertaking. There is no hard and fast rule. At the same time, if primary source of data are available but you are not doing it, then there is no validity about you know, vis-a-vis your study, because in spite of the primary data available, you are not using it. And I think something more was about a research proposal. We responded about the number of pages, and when I recall it,
but as you were discussing that, whenever we have both primary and secondary data, we always need to have a primary data first. But if at all we don't have it,
yes,
then we can always rely on the secondary data. There is no difficulty about it.
Yeah.
There is no problem.
Because, you know, secondary data has its own importance, actually. Like, you know, if there are certain things recorded in a particular institution, and if you want to study,
yes,
only thing is that you have to make sure the authenticity of the documents. For that, you will have to scrutinize it, and how these data were, you know, stored and all those things, you might have to, you know, go into detail with. Otherwise, secondary, you know, source of data has its own importance.
Yes. For example, as you were telling that we need to find out the authenticity of the data,
yes.
And also who has written that data, the author of the data, the author of that particular report, or maybe
yes.
That has to be. If the report is coming from the Ministry of, say, Human Resource Development, that we need not to doubt about it.
Yes,
but if
and
someone
also,
has,
yeah, also yes. We corroborate it with from different sources.
Yes,
like you know, see something which is stored here in the university, something which is sent to the ministry. So whether these data tally.
So
it all, you know, there are different ways you can establish authenticity.
Yes, very right. Very right. We were on to the different kinds of methods, and one question which came from Patna, I think we have not answered it, that was about how much sample should one take about.
Yes, yeah.
So that I think I'll take up in the next slide. Mm-hmm. I think we'll be able to answer that question. So first of all, whenever we have to fix what population are we going to have. So what do we mean by population of the problem? What will include the population? The population of the research will be nothing but the collection of the elements, object or subjects that possess the information which is sought by you. That means the population will be that number of people from where you want to fetch information. That will be your population. For example, if you want to conduct a study of, say, to find out the burnout in the, say, at the secondary level teachers. So the population will include all the teachers, with those who are teaching at the secondary level. So that will include all the population. But then it will not be feasible for you to go and collect the data from each one of the teachers, because they might be in hundreds or thousands. So keeping in mind the time and the money and the effort which that will go in to cover the entire population, there we introduce the concept of sample.
Yes.
So,
and sometimes, you know, we reflect that in the title itself. For example, in this particular title I have cited here, we will take that call now. So Delhi is mentioned.
Yes.
So from Delhi again you may restrict the, because now
entirely.
Delhi becomes a population, from there again you will call out your sample.
True.
Let's take the Shillong call.
Yes, we can have the
yes,
call,
Shillong.
Yes, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Yes, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Please go ahead.
Yes, only one question. Do we need to work under a guide or a supervision or by ourselves?
Yeah, this is what I forgot to respond. See, it is better to have a guide from the university you are working or somewhere near there, because you can actually consult with that particular resource person or the guide. And suppose you have already conducted research, if you are a PhD holder or an MPhil holder, and if you are very confident about your research skills, you need not have a research guide. If you are not very confident, please go ahead, talk to someone, have them as your guide to, or a kind of a mentor to help you out how to carry out the research.
So we can just start off as you were discussing about the population of the research.
Yes.
So as Dr. Aisha has mentioned that sometime in the title of the study itself you mention about the population, say to study the burnout amongst the secondary school teachers in the Delhi region only.
Yes.
So Delhi is your population area and you have specified in your title. So you can always write your title that way also. But as we were discussing that the entire population cannot be taken as a sample because of the feasibility
yeah.
factor in terms of time, efforts and money. So that is why the concept of sample has to be introduced. So the sample is nothing but it is a representative of the population. The sample, whenever we talk about a sample will consist of the people from the population itself, the objects from the population itself, but the number will be smaller than that of a population, and the concept of sample is introduced to minimize the effort and the time which is involved in the study. And there was a question, I think, that how much should be the sample of the study.
Mm-hmm.
Again, in response of that, we can say that the sample of the study will again depend upon what kind of study you are undertaking. For example, if you are undertaking a survey research, wherein you want to find out, say, the status of guidance services in Delhi, Delhi administration schools, say for example. So to find out the status, therein you will have to have a larger sample. But in case if you want to find out, say, the cultural practices in a certain tribe, the tribe itself has a smaller number. So you will have to restrict your sample to a very small number. But ideally, we often say that a number beyond 30 is always considered to be a larger sample. So I think this the question is been answered that way. So it will always depend upon what kind of research you are conducting.
And what is more important is, how you select the sample.
Mm-hmm.
How the sample is representative of the population.
Mm-hmm.
Even if the number is small, how representative that particular sample is of the population is more important than, say, if they have 300 as a sample, but if it is taken from one particular area alone, so that is not representative of the
entire population. Yes.
Right. So whereas that 30 may work out, because if they have taken the sample in such a fashion that they represent different groups in that particular population.
Mm-hmm. For example, I'll just elaborate with one example. As we have given you an example, say burnout of secondary teachers in Delhi region.
Yes.
Delhi itself is divided into 13 sub-regions. So, if suppose I'm there in, say, South Delhi, if I want to conduct, say, a study of this kind, and if I go to the teachers, those who are teaching in South Delhi schools, that sample will not be the representative of the entire population.
Yes.
That is what Dr. Aisha was hinting at.
So, the more important is the technique you use to select that particular sample.
Yes.
I think now that too.
Wind up.
Yeah.
Okay. So when we were talking about the technique, the concept of sampling comes in. So sampling, that means with the help of various sampling methods, you can always choose your sample. And there are basically two kinds of sampling methods. That is the probability sampling and a non-probability sampling. The whenever we talk about a probability sampling, that will basically help you to get the better representative of the population, because through the probability sampling we select the data randomly. That is, a random selection of the data is there. So the concept, the biasness selection of the sample can be limited, and it could be of various kinds: the simple random sampling, stratified, cluster, so many different kinds. Another kind of sampling technique is a non-probability sampling, wherein just in contrast to the probability sampling, wherein we don't have a say. For example, if I want to conduct a study, there is no randomization. I can go anywhere, collect the data and come back. So there is no representative. So whenever you are selecting about the kind of sampling procedure which you will be using, then probability sampling has always got an edge over non-probability sampling. And there are various types of non-probability sampling, such as convenient sampling, judgmental sampling, quota sampling, snowball sampling. There are many different kinds of sampling which could be there.
And it also depends on what exactly you are going to find out. So the nature of the study, that also determines how you are going to actually select your sample. For example, if you want to study about smokers, and their some kind of a health problem related to them, obviously you cannot have a random sampling.
Yes.
Because they are just not available in that.
Everywhere.
So therefore,
so that will introduce purposeful sampling.
Yeah. Okay. We'll take the call from Patna. Yes, Patna.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, we can hear.
नमस्कार मैडम.
नमस्कार.
हाँ, हम पटना रीजनल सेंटर से डॉक्टर अमिनाश बोल रहे हैं
जी.
एक्चुअली एक क्वेश्चन है, द स्टडी ऑफ रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन अ स्ट्रेस एंड बर्नआउट. तो इसको थोड़ा एक्सप्लेन करने की कोशिश करेंगे, और खास करके बर्नआउट को डिटेल्स में, तो हमारे लिए बेहतर होगा.
नहीं, वी आर नॉट गोइंग टू डू दैट राइट नाउ. हेलो, आई एम वेरी सॉरी टू से दैट, हम अभी वो नहीं करेंगे, क्योंकि दैट इज जस्ट अ टाइटल. वी कांट गो इन टू द डिटेल्स ऑफ वॉट इज बर्न आउट, वॉट इज स्ट्रेस, वॉट इज मीनिंग इन लाइफ, बिकॉज दैट इज नॉट द पर्पज ऑफ दिस पर्टिकुलर
you know, session, and we also have to wind it up in 4 minutes time right now. We are actually only discussing the technicality of preparing a research proposal.
So after you select about the sample, we have talked about the what kind of method you will be choosing, then the population which you will be taking, and then sample. After you select out what sample you will have, you will then have to think about that from that particular sample, how are you going to get the data, the various kinds of data collection techniques.
Yes.
So you can always, there are various kinds of data gathering tools which are available, that could be psychological tests which are already always standardized, which can be available. Suppose you want to find out the aptitude, the scientific aptitude amongst the student. The scientific aptitude test is already available.
Yeah.
So these kind of a test having a psychological nature or maybe psychological characteristics, they are already available, they are already standardized, they are already validated, and the reliability is also being calculated, so they are very easily and readily available. The other important kind of a tool is observation, where you go and you observe, say, the habits of the respondents from where you want to collect the data. Observation is one such tool which is often used in a qualitative research mode.
Yes. And Planter and others have used it even in the, they have quantified
they
it.
They have
like,
quantified
you know, classroom
it.
Practices, etc.
Yes. The other kind of tools which you can use could be an interview. The interview could be a structured interview and an unstructured interview. When we say that an interview has to be structured, that therein we mean that it is already pre-planned. You have just found, you have just written down all the domains and the test items. You have calculated the reliability and the validity. That is called a structured interview. An unstructured interview, that means you go on and you just ask a question, whatever comes in your mind. So that is again another kind of a tool. Then a questionnaire. A questionnaire is nothing but a written form of an interview sometimes. So a questionnaire could be a tool which you can use for a data gathering. Then sociometric techniques. For example, if you want to find out say what the social relationships which are existing in the groups, maybe in a classroom or in other social situations, then these techniques, the sociometric techniques, they can be of a great help. Then the other kind of a tool is inventory. Through an inventory, you can always get an opinion in the form of a yes or no. That is what. Whether if you want to say find out the what are the kinds of facilities or infrastructure facilities available in say government school. So you can prepare an inventory. Whether the that inventory could be used, and you can fetch the data from your respondents. Then finally, you come out to come to the analysis of the data. Again, depending upon the data, the analysis of the data could be of the two types. That is, the qualitative data analysis, and other could be the quantitative data analysis. The qualitative data analysis includes the thick description that includes the content.
And also, you try to you look for patterns.
Yes.
If there is an emerging pattern in that, whether with the existing theory or a new theory emerging out of that.
True.
So that is how we analyze the qualitative description data like
yes.
that.
Yes. And the quantitative data that can be analyzed through parametric and non-parametric techniques. See, these two kinds of the techniques are beyond the scope of this program. So you can always go back and read into the books about these
yeah,
programs.
Some of them, like you can just mention some of those.
Yeah, the parametric like techniques might include, say, measures of central tendency, then t-test, f-test. T-test is used to find out the, say, if you want to find out the difference between the two groups, whether they differ on two, for example, if you want to find out, say, the difference between the academic achievement of boys and girls, so therein you can use a t-test. But t-test is always used between when you want to compare only two groups. If you want to compare more than two groups, then you use f-test. So this is a parametric techniques. And the non-parametric techniques, they will include chi-square, median test, sign test. There's so many tests which are there. But one thing I would like to hear mention, that a parametric test is always used when you have taken the sample through random measures, that is the probability sampling, and non-parametric test is always used when you are taken a sample through a non-probability sampling. So depending upon the sampling procedure, the analysis will also fall back. Okay. So that is the last step of your research proposal which you have to mention. Right. Delimitation, I think we have already discussed. And after that, you will have to just write the references from where you have collected all the details.
Yeah.
So that will include the entire structure of the research proposal.
I think now the time is up. We'll have to wind up presently. So we hope these two sessions have been of some use to you. It will generate a kind of a discussion there in your group, and probably you would like to discuss it with your resource persons, whatever your doubts remaining. We have thoroughly enjoyed the session with you. We would have liked more questions coming from you. Okay, I can understand it must have been a warm-up session, the first one, and at least in the second session you have been very, very active and lively participating. Thank you very much for joining us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.